Good morning and happy Mother's Day to one and all. It's a little bit, well, the flowers are trying their best to cheer up the outdoors, so it's up to us this morning to be as cheerful and bright as we can possibly be on this somewhat cloudy day. And we have good reason to be cheerful because we have a visiting preacher who is going to be spectacular, and you are all spectacular, so how can we go wrong? And the choir. I'm Reverend Ned White, the interim senior minister here at the congregation, serving with the Reverend Jennifer Brower, who is behind me on the chancel, and the Reverend Dr. Natalie Fenimore, who is on sabbatical until July. And we have today as worship assistants Meg Cohen and Rachel Zampino. So we have a huge force here for the service today. We are honored to have the president of the Unitarian Universalist Association with us this morning, the Reverend Susan Frederick-Gray. Good. And she hasn't even spoken yet. Prior to her election in 2017, Susan served as lead minister of the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Phoenix, Arizona, where she played a critical role in the long-term campaign to end the constitutional violations of Maricopa County Sheriff Joe Arpaio, for which we are in your debt. Susan received a Masters of Divinity from Harvard Divinity School and a Bachelor of Science in Molecular Biology from the University of Wisconsin in Madison. That's a brilliant combination of degrees for ministry. She's a lifelong UU who grew up in the St. Louis area and now lives in Cambridge, Massachusetts with her husband, Brian, and their son. And I think you will be returning home so they can help you celebrate Mother's Day later today. We also welcome Jay Pasiti from the Stewardship and Development Office is here. And he is from Kennebunk, Maine. So we are indebted to him for today's weather. Thank you very much, Jay. It's great. If you are new here, please fill out a blue card so that we might be able to serve any needs that you might have. Following the service today, there will not be a UU Cafe because of Mother's Day, but you are welcome to stay for coffee and conversation as long as you wish. And there is a Mother's Day lunch for which people have signed up that will be taking place in the beach house. It is also an opportunity today to support grade 6 in purchasing Mother's Day flowers that benefit their super secret social action project, which will be revealed at next Sunday's bridging service. So don't miss that service next Sunday. This week, the Social Justice Mental Health Subcommittee is sponsoring a screening of A Beautiful Mind, followed by a discussion, and there will be details of that and other program opportunities this week in your order of service. So now I invite you, even though it looks a little gloomy and dark and a little cool outside, to greet one another warmly.
We enter into worship with these words of Mary Oliver. If you suddenly and unexpectedly feel joy, don't hesitate. Give in to it. There are plenty of lives and whole towns destroyed or about to be. We are not wise and not very often kind, and much can never be redeemed. Still, life has some possibility left. Perhaps this is its way of fighting back, that sometimes something happened better than all the riches or power in the world. It could be anything, but very likely you notice it in the instant when love begins. Anyway, that's often the case. Anyway, whatever it is, don't be afraid of its plenty. Joy is not made to be a crumb. Don't hesitate.
Today's chalice lighting words are those of Marjorie Montgomery. Life is a gift for which we are grateful. We gather in community to celebrate the glories and the mysteries of this great gift. Please rise in body and spirit as we sing together hymn number 1000 in the teal hymnal book. Morning has come, number 1000.
For our words and song of affirmation, whose words are printed in your order of service. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest of truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve human need, this do we affirm and covenant with each other.
Thank you.
this time, I invite Klaus Masich, president of our congregation, and Meg Cohen, the chair of our membership committee, to come forward and help us welcome our newest members.
It is my joy to welcome those who have decided to join our congregation and draw more deep from the wells of our community of faith. We know that they will influence the health and direction of this congregation by participating in its ministries, leadership, and decision making. We welcome their vision, energy, and spiritual curiosity. I ask our members to come forward now with the order of service as I read your names. Ami Balkadar, Moyen Haig, Renee Curiali, Matthew Curiali, Lisa Franzike, Gerald Flesch, Sarah Flesch, Phyllis Gorwitz, Eileen Haas, Larry Haas, Linda Josenhans, Jean Kulis, Joel Kulis, Flo Moylett, Roberta Rayburn, Amy Singh, Lisa Trottenberg Sallow, Song Shine Han, Siobhan Taylor, Donald Weiss,
Well, I'm supposed to face you, but I'm just going to face that way so I can read this, okay? Our congregation has been shaped by generations of dedicated women and men who have given generously of their hopes and dreams, their energy and their resources. They have sought to build a community of faith in which all are welcomed and appreciated, and where all may find a center for inspiration, growth, and service. Many of those who were present at the beginning of our congregation's journey are no longer with us, yet their influence endures, and we remember them with deep appreciation. Because of their vision and their labor, which we carry forward, our circle grows and our influence for good expands in the lives of individuals, in families, and in the wider world. We welcome you into this community of worship and fellowship with hope for a long and ever-deepening relationship.
I invite our newest members to say together the words of affirmation printed in the order of service. They'll be followed by words of response from you, the entire congregation. First, the affirmation by new members. We enter into membership in this congregation. And the rest of the congregation,
we welcome you to this congregation to share our dreams and to join your strength and wisdom with ours as we create a future together. We pledge to you an openness of heart and mind and a willingness to grow with you in spirit, in understanding, and in fellowship.
As a further expression of our welcome, we invite the president of the UUA, Susan Frederick-Gray, to join us in extending to you the right hand of fellowship. And we get 2 weeks of Sharon, of little Sharon. So can't get any better than that.
On this day when we recollect mothers, our own, or ourselves, or women in our lives who have guided and nurtured us, we rediscover gratitude for the efforts and sacrifices others have made and continue to make on our behalf. In this spirit of gratitude, we participate in today's offering. For the work of this congregation and UU congregations everywhere, encouraging and inspiring one another to be caring and nurturing people. Will the ushers please come forward?
Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Shelter Rock. Oh, it is a joy to be with you all on this, well, I don't know that I would say lovely Mother's Day, but on this very special Mother's Day. And I want to thank this congregation, and especially Ned White and the incredible staff and ministry team of your congregation, Jennifer Brower and Natalie Fenimore, for your ministry and leadership and the hospitality this morning. I am grateful to be here with all of you, especially as I am nearing the end of my second year as president of your Unitarian Universalist Association. And more than anything, what I want to share with you this morning is my deep and abiding gratitude for your incredible support for Unitarian Universalism, for our congregations, for the UUA, and for our many UU organizations. You, the members and leaders of Shelter Rock, have given a transformational gift to our faith. Several years ago, you all made a bold commitment to leverage the resources and power of your congregation right here to inspire Unitarian Universalists and congregations all around the country to leave a legacy to Unitarian Universalism. I'm talking about the Wake Now Our Vision campaign. Through the Wake Now Our Vision campaign, you all pledged $5 million, $5 million to match a percentage of legacy and bequest intentions that would benefit Unitarian Universalism. I imagine that felt really risky and uncertain, but you all said yes, boldly. Boldly taking your leadership role and your ability to leverage generosity in this faith seriously. And wow, did you. Your pledge of $5 million leveraged, I don't know how many of you know this number, leveraged $85 million for the future of Unitarian Universalism. In total, that's $90 million. That's a transformational gift to our faith, to our institutions, to our congregations. And I know that you all don't get to hear all the stories. So I want to tell you about our small congregation, UU congregation in Cheyenne, Wyoming. There's one UU congregation in Wyoming called a young lesbian minister. They are doing phenomenal work. They raised over $750,000 in legacy intentions in Cheyenne, Wyoming. Birmingham, Alabama, another small UU congregation, raised over $500,000 in legacy intentions for their community. And I share these stories of these small congregations because their presence in those communities is literally life-saving. Places where there aren't other congregations that celebrate the spectrum of gender and sexual orientation, that model and try to live into radical inclusion. That's not easy to find in Wyoming or Alabama. And so many congregations across what's known as flyover America, that's where I'm from, flyover America, where progressive religion is so needed and so rare. Congregations in Ohio, Pennsylvania, Indiana, North Carolina, your generosity means that their ministries will have a greater capacity for mission and outreach, not just today, but for the long haul. You did that. You did that. And so today I bring not just my own gratitude, but the gratitude of the hundreds of congregations that benefited from Wake Now Our Vision, that were inspired by it, and now have a new story to tell. You know, so many of the stories that we tell about ourselves and about our world is about what we don't have, what we can't do. But you all have helped unlock a new story of what is possible when we are bold and visionary, when we take risks and sacrifice for this faith that we love. You showed us the power of we and the power of what we can do together. And I want to just say personally that I came into the presidency of the UUA. Those of you who have been here a longer time know that I came in at a time of tremendous turmoil and difficulty. Wake Now Our Vision was a way of inspiring a deeper commitment to our faith. I mean, I just can't tell you how personally that meant as a campaign, because it is helping us tell a different story about who we are, about our capacity and our generosity and the possibility of our faith. Thank you. I just want to tell you how much I care for all of you, how much I love you and this congregation. Some of you I have gotten to know over many years, and it is a real privilege to have this relationship with you during this short time that I hold this role as president of the UUA. Thank you for your partnership, for your commitment, and for what you make possible across this faith. What we do every day in our congregations matters and is needed. I am grateful for the ways that you support the UUA every year as a congregation and through the VEACH program, the ways you support UU initiatives and congregations all across this country, but especially today, I want to say thank you for the Wake Now Our Vision campaign and what it has unlocked and will continue to make possible for our faith all across this country. Thank you.
Friends, I invite you now into a time of meditation, of individual reflection and contemplation. I know we've talked about how dreary it is outside, and dreary it is. But I will confess that I like rainy Sundays. I think it makes this sanctuary feel very cozy and very intimate and connects us to each other. I'm sorry that screen is down today, but you who can see out this window, you've got that. That rain draws us in. So I invite you to be here in this space. Eyes open, eyes closed, whatever's comfortable for you. To take a deep breath and just focus on being. Not on what comes next in the order of service. Not on what comes next in your day. But just to be here, in your body, with these people, in this moment. One of so many, many, many moments that make up our lives, but that will never come again. Appreciate this moment and the holy quiet of this hour. And remember to breathe, even if it's noisy breathing. In the stillness, may we find some measure of peace from whatever tension or anxiety or burden we carry today. No matter what we look like on the outside, We each have our own stuff to drag around, and some of it's heavy and hard to bear. So let us find some way to put a little bit of it down here today. In the quiet of this time, let us listen to the yearnings of our hearts. There's so much we want out of this life for ourselves and for our loved ones, for our community of faith, for the community in which we live, for this larger world. May the peace we find here help us to find the strength not only to endure all that we must schlep around with us, but that helps us grow in health and wholeness. On this day, when we are prompted to remember those who gave us life and nurtured our early years, let us acknowledge that many among us carry feelings that are far more complicated than the florist and card sellers would lead us to believe. The relationship of mother and child is not always a vision of sweetness and light. Not all who've given birth or raised children have had the resources they needed to be their best selves. So let us extend a special prayer of affirmation for those whose feelings are complicated or conflicted, for those who feel regret or shame or sorrow or hurt or disappointment, and to those who would not remember their mother today or maybe any day. Let us remember with tenderness the mothers and mothering others who are departed, those gone from the life we know and understand, and those whose health prevents them from being in relationship with us. How hard it is for those whose mothers are there in body, but who no longer see them. We hold in prayerful embrace the children of all ages, whose absence is sharply felt on this day when the bond between mother and child is celebrated. And at this time, we hold in mind those whose names and faces and those whose possibility are etched in memory. Whether we have come into this day feeling sadness or joy, or something far more difficult to name and categorize, today may we each grow in our awareness and appreciation for life's gifts of relationship. Today, if no other day, let us give deep thanks for those people, male or female, or neither, family members, friend, or fellow congregant who's loved us, or guided us, affirmed us, steered us in our own true growing. May we find ways to express that love and support in words and through the deeds of our living, that we may offer the gifts of compassion and nurture and care to others, younger and older. For these prayers and for those you hold in your hearts, I say so may it be, and may you feel held. Amen.
Thank you.
beautiful. Well, I'm excited to be here with you all on Mother's Day. And just so you know, as a minister, this has always been a work day for me, and one that I adore. I love that one of the foundations of this holiday of Mother's Day is the Unitarian abolitionist and suffragist and activist Julia Ward Howe, who saw this day not as one of flowers and Hallmark cards, although those are lovely, but as a day for women to leave the home and their work and to demand that society and government take seriously the values of peace and justice. Later, not now, but later you can look in your hymnal for Julia Ward Howe's Mother's Day proclamation from 1870, in which she called women to leave their homes and demand an end to war. It was for her a day of action. It was envisioned a day of action to promote the values that mothers and caregivers work so hard to instill in young people, the values of compassion and care, the values of justice and peace. And this history reminds us that this is not the first time when injustice, indignity, oppression, and violence have ruled the day, ruled our country in many ways. This is not the first time. But it also reminds us that as Unitarian Universalists, we have always had an important role in fighting for justice. This is an important day in our history and in our legacy. And as the first woman elected president of the UUA, I'm proud and honored to follow in the footsteps of the courageous women of our faith. Indeed, these times that we are living in offer us daily reminders of how much our faith matters and how much it is needed. For ours is a life-changing, life-affirming, life-saving faith. And I know this personally, because when I was 5 years old, Unitarian Universalism saved my life. When I was 5 years old, the people, the ministry, and two very special religious education teachers at Elliott Unitarian Chapel, where I grew up, dramatically changed my life. A little shout out to all of our RE teachers. You all don't know the difference that you make. You see, when I was a little kid, in fact, for most of my young life, my family was falling apart. Now, a more accurate word would be erupting. There were a lot of reasons for it. I won't go into them all. One was that my parents were on the verge of divorce. What it meant was that my home was not a peaceful or joyful place. But I have another powerful memory from my childhood, and it was of my kindergarten Sunday school class. The class was taught by a married couple, and what I remember still to this day was how much fun we had in that class and how much they seemed to love each other. They would play guitar and sing songs, and we five-year-olds would dance around and sing along. It was joyful, and wow, did I need that joy. I wrapped it around me. It was once a week for an hour, for a few months in my life, but it stayed with me, as did my love for those two people. As Mary Oliver writes, if you suddenly and unexpectedly feel joy, don't hesitate. Lean into it. Perhaps joy is life's way of fighting back. Now, to be clear, too many children experience far worse. And studies increasingly show how these early childhood experiences can affect our long-term health outcomes, including the development of addiction, and mental health challenges. And not all stories have such good outcomes. But studies also tell us the outsized difference that a great teacher, a mentor, or the small presence of real care and attention can make in the lives of children who experience pain, neglect, or trauma growing up. This Sunday school class, even though I did not have words for it, nor fully understand its impact until years later, it showed me that something else was possible. That something else was possible in a marriage, that something else was possible in a family, that something else was possible for me. That gift, that seed of joy and possibility, it shaped decisions in my life for years to come. Now, I share this story with the permission of my parents. It is one they know well, although a different side of it, to be sure. And you know what? They even found their way through those many difficult years to a marriage built in partnership and mutuality, and I know that our congregation had a role in that as well. Here's the thing about our congregations. Here's the thing about joy. I don't think we take it seriously enough. Let me talk about joy first. Think about a time when you felt real joy. When I feel joy, I feel free. I feel safe. I feel loved. And that is the condition that we want for all people. Joy and love help nurture possibility and imagination and hope in our lives. Joy also helps us imagine something better for our world. And when our congregations, our communities of that nurture joy and love, they become places of transformation in both small and in large ways. Truthfully, this faith, our congregations, our people have saved my life and saved my butt sometimes. I should say that for my youth advisors to call them out. Saved my life again and again. And I don't say this frivolously, I mean it. You know, Unitarian Universalism taught me courage. It taught me to take risks for what I believed in, even if it meant being a lone voice. It taught me and continues to teach me every day to love abundantly and boldly and to remember the saving power of community and joy. And it gave me another most precious gift. It gave me a religion that made it clear that the work of justice is inseparable from a faith rooted in love. The work of justice is inseparable from a faith rooted in love. Now, this notion that our theology is inseparable from the work of justice, that is deeply rooted in our history. You see, our Universalist forebears did not believe in hell except for the one that we create right here in this life, the hell that is created through the conditions like poverty and exploitation. And as Universalists, they understood that salvation was not individual but collective, and that our work in the world, theologically and morally, as Universalists, as Unitarian Universalists, is to bring a powerful, active form of love to confront the conditions that create hell for people in this life. And for all the humanists out there, of which I am one, that's a pretty good humanist foundation, right? To bring the power of love to confront the conditions that create hell for people. Now, this connection of our theology to the work of justice is a reminder that the work of justice making requires spiritual work alongside our intellectual analysis and our organizing. But the injustice that we are witnessing and experiencing today is not just political, social, and economic. It is deeply spiritual, particularly in the ways that systems of domination and exploitation dehumanize both victim and perpetrator and cut us all off from the power and the gift of our experience of our common humanity and our fundamental interdependence. Mary Oliver says it's in those connected spaces when we feel love that joy arises. Systems of exploitation and domination cut us off from joy. So today, in the face of an onslaught of injustice and loss, our congregations continue to be a way of fighting back against despair, fighting back against acquiescence, and fighting back against this corruption of our humanity
by providing joy and love, by nurturing hope and courage. But I want to make something really clear, because this is so important. The hope that Unitarian Universalism provides is not a guarantee that everything will be all right. That kind of hope is only there to mollify us, and we don't need to be mollified, my friends. Right? We need to be encouraged to take greater risks and be more bold to fight for the human worth and dignity of each and every person. Instead, hope, the powerful, active hope of our tradition, is found in the fact that we can see clearly the reality of our circumstances, and yet we still have some choice in how we will show up, in how we will give, in how we will love. Hope is found in that struggle. Hope is found in that choice, that agency to do something with our lives to make a difference for others and for one another. Hope is found in a religion that nurtures the fullness of our humanity, that recognizes our capacity for great compassion and great cruelty, our capacity for altruism and greed, because both of those are a part of the human condition. A religion that can recognize that and then teaches us again and again to choose love, to choose compassion. In 1963, in his book, The Strength to Love, Dr. Martin Luther King wrote these words about the essential role of the religious community. He said, "The church must be reminded that it is not the master or the servant of the state, but rather the conscience of the state. And if the church does not recapture its prophetic zeal, it will become an irrelevant social club without moral or spiritual authority. If the church does not actively participate in the struggle for peace and for economic and racial justice, and today I would add climate justice, it will forfeit the loyalty of millions and cause people everywhere to say that it has atrophied its will." Whew. But, he says, "But if the church will free itself from the shackles of a deadening status quo and recovering its great historic mission, will speak and act fearlessly and insistently in terms of justice and peace, it will enkindle the imagination of humankind, imbuing them with a glowing and ardent love for truth and justice and peace." Listen for how King is connecting the mission of the church and the ways that it enkindles the imagination, the possibility of humankind. There is deep truth here, and it is connected to what Mary Oliver writes about joy. We must be committed fearlessly and insistently to justice and peace, and we need communities that love us, that love the fullness of who we are, that create space for joy, and that nurture possibility in our lives and in our families. We are living in a moment that reflects the very choice that King lays bare before us. As humanity faces dramatic challenges, unbelievable challenges of climate disruption and global migration, we hear the rhetoric of scarcity, isolation, and walls grow. This is a reactionary response, believing the failing status quo can somehow be restored, however unjust, rather than responding from a sense of mission and possibility that helps us imagine a new path forward. Now, this is not that surprising, because in times of challenge and transition, institutions often grow fearful. They pull back, right? But in reality, in times of transition and challenge, what we need more than anything is vision and boldness. There is opportunity in these moments of challenge. You know, one of the things I learned when I visited the Grand Canyon that was different than how I learned it in school is that it's not that the Colorado River carved the Grand Canyon slowly, steadily, year after year. It was that seismic changes actually created moments where huge amounts of change happened, right? But in these challenging times when we pull back, when we're afraid, we actually miss the opportunity before us to do something bold that will make deep change in our world. And this is both short-sighted and heartbreaking. Because when we approach the challenges of our days with fear and scarcity, we shut down human ingenuity and we cut our hearts off to the greatest gift within us, which is the gift of compassion and the capacity to love. My friends, we as human beings, there is a lot to us, but we were made for love. We were made to nurture life. We were made to care for each other and build loving community. This is why everywhere I go, I lift up, and you've heard me say this before, but I lift up two messages. This is no time for a casual faith and no time to go it alone. The challenges before us as a nation are literally life and death. For Muslims and Jews, for Black and Brown people, for immigrants and refugees, for trans folks, for women, for children, for people with disabilities and the poor, the list of people under threat and losing their rights grows daily. Right now, we need to take more risks. I want you to hold on to that. We need to take more risks. Those of us who are free, those of us who have some privilege, we need to take more risks to protect one another and our core institutions, because the beloved community is about providing that safe space for a child who needs a break from a troubled home, as well as providing sanctuary for that family fighting desperately to stay together. The beloved community is about the work that we do internally to care and love each other, and the work we do outside to build more justice. They are not two things. Our internal work to nurture community and our work for justice are not two separate things. They foster and strengthen one another. And following the call to beloved community, to live this deep joy and love inside, and to risk more for justice outside, is the difference between our congregations being mere social clubs and actually being the church that we were created to be, right? I believe what has long led to the decline in institutional religion is that too many congregations and faith institutions just grew complacent, bound by what King called the shackles of a deadening status quo. Too many failed to act up, to speak out as we were losing ground on this country, on racial equity, voting rights, and poverty, and we've been losing ground on those issues for a long time, for a generation. Too often the church remained silent or ineffective, too comfortable in privilege or too caught up trying to serve individual preferences and failing to realize that there's a larger historic mission that calls us forward to respond to the real need of people and families and children in our communities. And I dream of what it would mean to unlock the calling to the beloved community, to unlock this calling to bring our bravest, our boldest, and our most loving selves to love the hell out of this world in old universalist fashion. Right? Just love the hell out of it. In how we treat each other and in how we act in the world. There is power in our institutions as Unitarian Universalists if we are but willing to use it, leverage it, and even sacrifice for it. Your commitment and investment in Unitarian Universalism is one of the most powerful ways that you make a difference in this world. And that's not just because of what we work to resist, it's because of what we work to build up. It's about OWL, the Comprehensive Sexuality Program. It saves lives every day. You know, I hear young people tell me wherever I go, OWL saved my life. GLBT young people, people who've experienced abuse, saying OWL gave me language to understand what was happening. Saved my life. It's about the ways we show up and care for one another in times of need and grief, the way we teach love in the face of fear, and celebrate religious pluralism in a time of growing nationalism and religious extremism. It's about how we show up and side with love and how we respond in disaster, in times of disaster. You know, after the tragic, just unbelievably tragic shooting at the Pulse nightclub in Orlando, do y'all remember that a couple years ago? It was your sibling Unitarian Universalist congregation that became the staging area for the first responders and the trauma responders. It was the Unitarian Universalist church where people could come to get pastoral care after that shooting and where first responders could find respite. There is power in our communities, in our congregations, and in what we do. Some of it's measurable and we can see and name as I have done, and some of it we'll never know. So I got a question for you all. What is the most important way that you can support the health and the vitality and the mission of Unitarian Universalism? Now, this may be a particularly unique question for you all as a congregation, for you're unlike any of our other UU congregations in terms of your financial means. You're also like every one of our congregations in terms of the ways that you nurture families and children, offer programs for adult learning, the ways you care for one another in times of grief and show up for justice. You're both unlike and exactly like all of our congregations. And so I'm clear on how I'm framing this question. It's not about what are you as the UU congregation of Shelter Rock, what's the biggest difference you can make? I'm asking you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and me, and you, what is the most important way that you can support the mission of Unitarian Universalism? It is right here, through your commitment and your generosity to this congregation. More than anything, that is the most important way that you make a difference in this faith and the peoples whose lives are touched by it. The members of the congregation where I grew up, they had no idea how their generosity, which supported that RE program, saved my life. And you all here, you will never know all the stories of the peoples whose lives have been nurtured, shaped, and changed because of what you provide here in this congregation and what you give to make it possible. And so I want to thank you more than anything for your commitment to the mission of this congregation and for your support of the larger association. But it all begins right here. And I know that I could not do what I do, and that the UUA could not do what it does to equip congregations, to train leaders that we need for ministry today, and to advance our values on a larger scale without your support. My friends, these times are calling for our congregations and for all of us as Unitarian Universalists to recover our deep spiritual practices of joy and love and our great historic mission to nurture the possibility and the practice of beloved community. May we answer this call together. I love you all. I'm so grateful to be with you.
So our closing hymn, which Susan has requested, is 1051 in the teal hymnal, We Are. And you'll notice that it has, for those who are not music readers, it has some lines with little dots on it, which means that you go back and sing the same thing twice. So if you know music, help out your neighbors. And the choir, I'm sure, will help us out, and Nathaniel and George. And thank you, George, for standing in today as our conductor. It's great. So let's give it a try. This is Issei Barnwell's We Are, number 1051. Let's stand as we sing this together.
Made today. May we give thanks for the precious gift of life. In the midst of trials and tumult, may we keep our senses open to the beauty and the gifts that are present in life. May we kindle more joy, more love, and more song into our hearts and into our days. May we be led out in peace, and may we give back love. Go in peace, go in love.